guys, BDE Podcast. Here we have Dr. Nick Rolnick on the podcast today. Why don't you go ahead and introduce yourself, man?
Now, for me, I'm a physical therapist and personal trainer with his own practice. I have two different businesses. I have an education business where I get to teach other physical therapists and rehab providers around the world this new technique called blood flow restriction, which is which is a rehab technique. It's not a sexual technique. although I'll be honest, like there is at least one or two people in any of the courses that I teach that either ask questions, can you use this on what we jokingly refer to as the fifth cuff, which again, BFR for those is actually a really well-researched evidence-based modality that helps get people back to the activities that they love quicker than traditional therapies. And what we're doing now, which is part of the reason why I'm so excited about it. And I've been very fortunate enough to be a thought leader in this space. And so it's pretty sick, but, so you basically apply the cuff to the arm or the leg, pretty common actually in bodybuilding. I actually wrote a paper about it.
Real quick, let's let the people know. I mean, you used to bodybuild, you do bodybuild now. I mean,
yeah.
Let's see the bicep peak. Show a quick bicep shot. I mean, the kid is ripped and, all natural muscle right there. But let's even take it back. So like with the blood flow restriction training, before that there was it was like occlusion training, blood occlusion. They would.
It's the same thing. I mean, but
this is with these are cuffs, and that you set a certain amount of. How does it work?
Like pressure. Yeah, I mean, basically occlusion training, KAATSU training, blood flow restriction training, BFR training, venous occlusion. They all go by the same name, and they're basically doing the same thing, which is restricting arterial flow, so the blood is occluded going into the muscle, and it's restricted in some capacities from coming back. And what that ends up doing is creating a increased oxygen demand, so you can use light loads. And based on what we know about exercise science, if you exert yourself in any significant way, whether that's light loads, moderate loads, heavy loads, you can gain muscle size. And so it was once thought that you can only do that with lifting heavy weights, but now we're learning that's actually not true. The problem with light loads is that it takes a long time to be able to fatigue your muscles. And that's a challenge from the rehab perspective, which is what I teach, but also in other areas whereby if you're a bodybuilder, I wrote the paper that was published with actually Brad Schoenfeld.
Schoenfeld, for those who don't know, is a OG in the game of just fitness and training. I mean, he's been around forever.
We're actually coming up with another paper.
Is it public? Can I share that?
You can share it. Yeah. I mean, but if anybody's interested, they can always contact me and I can send them the paper.
Yeah. I'm going to put your information below.
Obviously. Yeah. So, but basically, it's really cool from a bodybuilding perspective because there is some emerging evidence that suggests that, that blood flow restriction can actually preferentially hypertrophy type 1 muscle fibers versus just type 2. I know we all talk about the type 2 muscle fibers, the ones that really are responsible for visible increases in muscle mass and strength. But when you're a bodybuilder and you're constantly lifting heavy loads day in and day out, and you're really getting to the point where you're not doing a lot of what I call spectrum training, which just means that And when I talk to individuals that are looking to optimize their physique, you want to make sure that you're doing some sort of high rep training, moderate rep training, and low rep training in order to try to hit all the spectrum of muscle fibers that are going to get recruited during exercise. So a lot of the bodybuilders that train, they typically tend to stay within the 6 to 12 rep range and lifting, you know, anywhere from 60 to 85% of their 1RM, but which again is effective, right? No one's gonna say it's not effective. But when you're looking to hit your genetic ceiling or above your genetic ceiling, if you're you're on some gear, yeah. You're enhanced. You need to be able to access all of the different technologies and tools that can help you really just hypertrophy all those muscle fibers that you wouldn't normally get the opportunity to do otherwise. And that's why it's very intriguing from a science perspective to see that you can get some low load BFR that can help accelerate the type 1 muscle fibers, where, again, like, if you're looking at why should you do BFR in the first place, I don't necessarily think you need to do BFR. You can just lift light loads. But when you're bodybuilding, and I can give you an example, I've competed now 3 times in bodybuilding shows. And
what shows did you compete in?
NPC, and they were on gear, so they blew me
out.
You
were all natural.
Yeah, all natty.
You still look thick, though. I remember.
So people are coming in, and it's kind of crazy because, you know, I consider myself pretty decent shape, but people are coming in bigger and leaner than me, and I had it was insane to see. And then I went and I competed in a smaller show in Musclemania when I was in DC, and I ended up winning that one. But that was a small show. But those were more natural kind of guys, and it really is a truly different playing field when you're trying to compete. Which, again, it's fine. I mean, like, everyone is who they are, and nobody can say otherwise. Like NPC, you're gonna go and you're gonna compete against guys that are enhanced. And again, that's just, if you want to compete, you want to compete, and that's fine.
Yeah.
But so the bodybuilders in general, typically when you're in a prolonged contest prep of 10, 12, 16, 20, 24 weeks, you're a prolonged caloric deficit. You're actually not in the position to put on muscle mass. It's just not going to happen.
Without gear, obviously.
Yeah. I mean, if you're a new lifter and you know, it's called body recomposition, whereby you can actually take off fat and put on muscle at the same time. That's definitely something that's very plausible and has been actually shown to happen in very new lifters. So therefore, like, for me, like, you can go on, or for me, when I'm advising like my personal training clients or even my rehab clients, they can go on a diet and actually put on muscle mass because it's something you can be able to do. But when you're pushing your genetic ceiling and you're really trying to get to that next level and you've had a lot of training experience, you're not going to be able to do that. And so when you go into a bodybuilding prep, that is the whole philosophy of the bulk, right? Which is try to get as much muscle size as you possibly can in off season to then go into training. And now your sole goal is to go into enough of a deficit whereby you're not taking away from the muscle mass that you've gained in your off season. And then you're just looking to burn fat. And that's why the concept of a very prolonged prep is ideal, because you're looking at a 24 week period of time whereby now, instead of going on a diet of like 600, 700, 800, 900, even 1,000 calories a week of per day that you're going to be doing. So you're looking at a 7,000 calorie a week deficit, which is not good. You can go on a 250 calorie diet a day. So now you're looking at pretty much just gradually stepwise lowering your caloric intake, because you don't want to shock your metabolism to the point where it's going to, now you're going to crush all your gains that you've gotten in the off season. Yeah. Second, like, your metabolism ultimately will adapt anyways. So it's better to just do a nice slow and steady intake. But that's, so getting back to the point, what I was saying is that when you're deep in contest prep and you still need to lift moderate to heavy loads, right? So in order to really stimulate as much anabolic activity as you can, the where blood flow restriction can come into play here is it can reduce the volume needed in order for you to get a training effect at light loads. So you can deload yourself as well. So there's a couple of different applications, like bodybuilding. Like, when you're looking at, again, what do you want to do when you're deep in a contest prep? You're going to lower the intensity, relatively speaking, and you're going to increase the volume. Well, that, if you're doing moderate loads, then, and heavy loads, your joints are taking a pounding, all that stuff. So what did BFR do? It allows you to reduce the stress in your joints at the same time as potentially creating this novel stress to your system. And it's just very, it's a nice adjunct tool that you can use for the bodybuilding and the physique, you know, competitors, or just anyone looking to optimize their physique in general?
I've tried it before, and it's crazy. I mean, remember when you set it up first when I was squatting?
Yeah.
I mean, it's tough. Like, it really, you feel like you're lifting like 500 pounds, but you're like, I think I was just doing my body weight.
Yeah, you were just doing your body weight.
It's just crazy. And do you think a bodybuilder can, I know you said it's just an adjunct tool, but do you think a bodybuilder could only use BFR for off season and pre-contest? Like, do you think it's possible?
I think where BFR likely has the best role is an adjunct. I think that as a short-term solution, absolutely, you can spend 1 to 2, even 3, 4 weeks just doing BFR as a way to provide that unique and novel stress. Because what people also don't it's not as publicized.
Yeah.
Is that your muscle actually needs? So we all talk about what we call myofibrillar hypertrophy, which is just the concept that you're going to add more of these little threads that assist in muscle contraction, and you have hundreds to thousands of them that create what's called the muscle fiber, and then we have hundreds of those that create what's called the muscle, mm-hmm. basically. And so it's a scaled
actual muscle. What builds that muscle tissue? Is that what that?
Yeah. Yeah. So that's what we're talking about with hypertrophy. We're actually creating, which ultimately is visible as increases in cross-sectional area. It's all of these myofibrils that get added, that ultimately the thousands of them, you know, they bulk up and they create that muscle. There's also something called sarcoplasmic hypertrophy, which means that you're adding some of the volume that are non-contractile tissues, which really up to like even like a couple months ago, people were like, this doesn't really exist. But now studies are coming out to show that actually bodybuilding type routines can create sarcoplasmic hypertrophy, which literally just means that when you get a pump, your muscles just become freaking massive. And honestly, it's funny because like I'm dieting and like my arm size used to be like bigger. Now I'm like, I think 15 and change, not flexed. And then when I get, or 15, when I'm like flexed, no pump, when I go post workout, it's 17 and change, like a massive change in size. And that could be attributed to some of that sarcoplasmic hypertrophy where literally the pump, you just have more space now for that blood and all that shit to come in and just rush into the muscle tissue. So there's a legitimate component for that. And BFR and heavy load training, you know, interspersed can really help maximize some of that. But I think BFR in the grand scheme of things, like if you're going to pick BFR versus heavy load training, you're sadly mistaken. And I think that you're making a terrible decision. But for a 4-week block, for example, where you're just like, you know, my elbow is hurting me a lot. Like, you know, I just want to make sure that I'm at least on the very minimal, on the very low end maintaining on the very up end, maybe I'm adding a little bit of size that is just from the unique stress of the exercise that I'm able to do. And that's where I think BFR can have some applicability, is like that last little bit, that 6 to 10 week period of time where you're going toward contest prep, or you're just dieting in general. And you're just like, you know what? I want to look good for the beach. Like I want to look shredded. And you're lifting your weights, you're dieting. You realize that when you diet and you're not in a surplus, your injury risk actually goes up.
So
anybody that's competed is gonna understand that, like, once you start to get into that prolonged period of time where you're in a deficit, you have aches and pains all over.
Your knees
hurt, your elbows hurt. Like it's a thing that it's almost
that's
like,
even that's before you cut water and everything.
Yeah. I mean, it's literally like, you know, the sun is going to come up every day. Unless something happens with that, you know, I don't know.
weird
stuff is happening.
Weird
yeah.
world right now.
Like, you know that you're going to have aches and pains, like, and you know that what people also don't understand about bodybuilding as well, which is just hilarious, is that like, yeah, we come shredded, like, but you're literally the most unhealthy that you are at in your entire life the day you step on stage.
I'm really glad you said that, because like, a lot of people think like these bodybuilders are healthy, but
oh my gosh, terrible.
Even the natural people that are like low body fat, your body does not want to be.
No. When you compete, all right, this is how I think about it. You are quite literally going against millions of years of evolution. Evolution and how we've evolved as hunter-gatherers, and basically trying to put on as much body fat as possible, because there's going to be periods of time where we're not going to be able to eat. It could be days, could be weeks, right? So our body has an affinity to store fat. That's how we have evolved. So now you're going to go and you're going to do the exact opposite. You are going to literally starve yourself for weeks to months on end and get to the point where you're walking on stage, but quite literally you're dead inside. Like, at least that's how I felt. You know, wow. You're always excited to step on stage, and obviously, you know, it's an accomplishment, and you've starved yourself for for weeks to months, but you're really stepping on stage at some of your unhealthiest health. Yep. And so people don't understand that there's a lot of negative things that can happen with competing. And you know, my hormone profiles, my sense of self, how I felt before and after kind of is dramatically changed. And it took me years to get back to feeling like I'm myself.
Way, really?
Yeah. Like, it took me years. And again, I, if I would have done it over again, I would have hired a coach to, like, for a diet, especially, to help with that. But I love the sport. I mean, I see bodybuilders. I love working with them. They're the most stubborn motherfuckers, though, because you tell them they need to do something and they're going to do it. Right.
Right.
Which is great, but they're also not going to stop lifting weights for any period of time. They're going to live within their own psyche. And I can tell you from experience that you look in a mirror and, you know, I have like veins on my arms all, but like, you know, you can always be better. Like, you're always your biggest critic. Mm-hmm. And that's the problem, because when you're your biggest critic, you have control of your own destiny. Nobody else. And so that's this whole psychosis that of the bodybuilder, where it's like,
psychosis.
I got to lift every day. I got to do something every day. And sometimes it actually ends up working against you. And there's this thing of what we call the rate of diminishing returns. And it actually happens with the hypertrophy literature, whereby one set is much better than lifting one set. And three sets is much better than lifting two sets. But the difference really between lifting three sets and one sets is, like, obviously it's better if you could do three versus one, but if you do 30 versus one, you know, doing one is actually less than doing 30. But actually, like, if I was going to think about it, like, maybe doing like 20 sets might be almost like maybe 95, 96% as good as doing 30 sets.
Yeah.
So then you ultimately, though, when you're lifting weights, you're breaking down your muscle tissue to then build it up further. So you have this whole thing of recovery. And when you're constantly in this psychosis of, I need to improve, I need to do something, you're not giving yourself enough rest. You're allured by the supplements, right? All these different things that really, for the most part, haven't been shown empirically to provide benefit. It's this whole subculture that, you know, I love being in shape. I love it, but there is this underbelly that of mental, you know, mental issues that needs to be talked about and needs to be addressed in a comprehensive and multifactorial program when you're working with someone like that, because it really is. I mean, I see bodybuilders for their rehab and they're great students because they do what you not want to do, but they also, you know, they also continue to lift. And that's something that you need to recognize as a provider, at least for me as a physical therapist, to understand, but it's just part of who they are. You know, I'm never going to stop lifting weights. I'm always going to find solutions to lifting. And I think BFR, getting back to that, is a very good, very good solution for the appropriate individual, because there are some people that shouldn't be using BFR. You know, it's just like anything. I mean, honestly, even exercise in certain people, if you come in with a blood pressure that's above 180 over 100, you know, you're really not going to be appropriate for exercise. Like literally they like 180 over 100, even like if you go to even more like 200, your systolic is 200 millimeters of mercury, right? You're in an, what we call a hypertensive crisis. Then you're not exercising. You ain't doing it. So
what about if someone has high blood pressure for BFR, does that...
Yeah, so it's funny that you mentioned that, because that's part of actually what I was talking about in my course today. Hypertension is not a contraindication, but there are some things that happen with our body. Our body it likes to be in balance, right? So if our body is not in balance, then there's a problem. The problem being is that when the body actually isn't in balance, the body doesn't recognize when the body is not in balance. Let me say that again. The body likes to be in balance, but when the body isn't in balance, the body doesn't know when the body's not in balance.
Right.
So when the body doesn't know when the body's not in balance, it's going to act like it's in balance. When you have these systems that are set up to help maintain blood flow during exercise and help our body live in this homeostasis when we're pressing, the pedal of the metal when we're lifting.
Right.
The response that when we exercise, but then when we exercise a BFR, could potentially be magnified with the application of BFR to levels that, depending on what we're trying to do with the BFR stress, could be very unsafe. So it's important to understand what strategies you can do for people that want to exercise with BFR that may be hypertensive. And typically my recommendation is they should be under the supervision of a certified skilled provider, somebody who understands what BFR can do. And then ultimately understands how they can help that person. It's definitely, medically speaking, it's important for BFR, because you are applying what's in essence a tourniquet, right? You're inflating it to a pressure that I know we can get into a lot of conversation that, but you're inflating it to a subocclusive pressure, meaning that you're always getting blood flow in, you're not getting blood flow out, and you're exercising at a loads that are typically between 20% and 40% of, or even up to 50% of the 1 RM. And you're doing it in repetitions of 30 repetitions on the first set, followed by a 30-second rest period, and then three sets of 15 repetitions, each with a 30-second rest period. That's the most typically researched protocol. But you can really just, honestly, you can do BFR in any way you want. Clinically, when I recommend and I teach people in my courses, 30-15-15-15. is the go-to, because that's like the what I like to refer as like the training wheels. Like, we know what's happening with BFR in certain populations when we do a 30, 15, 15, 15. Like, we have data for that.
When you say that, is that reps or?
Reps. Yeah. So it's four sets with 30 repetitions followed by three sets of 15. So we know that. So we have baseline. We have things that we can do to compare to the response. So I can expect that. We don't have the same data for something like a 20 repetitions followed by three sets of 12 and like one set of 15. We just don't. And that's part of the reason why clinically, when I teach, I want to make sure that we're using the most well-researched, evidence-based protocols in order to get our results. But if you're in the gym, you want to do five sets of 15 instead of four sets of 30, 15, 15, 15. So you're doing the same amount of repetitions. Well, then go for it. I mean, we just don't know the degree of improvement with that protocol versus something like a 30, 15, 15, 15, where we have research on that. So it's not like people need to be shackled to the protocol, but they need to understand that at the root level of the application of BFR, is that we're accelerating fatigue. That's literally it. So basically, if I'm lifting a 20% of the 1 RM lift, right, and it takes me 100 repetitions to get to that point where I'm like dying, where you're trying to move that weight as fast as possible, then nothing is happening. Like you're like, and you're barely moving it, right? That's how you know that you're actually doing some beneficial work. Because if you don't reach that point where you're trying to move that weight as fast as possible and nothing's, and it's not moving that fast, you ain't doing anything. You're just wasting your time. But what BFR does then is says, all right, well, for every repetition that I have with BFR, that counts for a repetition and a half or two repetitions for, or even three repetitions, depending on what lift you're doing, for the same exercise performed without BFR. So it can just accelerate the amount of time it takes for you to get.
Oh, it does accelerate the amount of time.
But yeah.
When I tried it, I mean, I couldn't believe it. I mean, it definitely feels like you're lifting a higher load when you're really in.
Yeah. And it's all about the fact that everything is tied into that our body wants to be in balance. And so what it's going to do is it's going to create signals that give our body or give you ultimately your cognition, the sense of, oh my gosh, I have a lot of muscle pain. I have a lot of discomfort. These are all things that are basically systems that are in check to keep your body in balance. And BFR kind of can throw that off a little bit. So that's why it's stressful when you're exercising, but it's a lot of fun too. I mean,
you get
a massive pump.
The pump is the one thing about it that I noticed is the pump is fucking nuts.
Yeah, pump is nasty. It's a nasty pump.
Nasty pump. Probably the nastiest pump that you can get.
It's a pretty good pump. It's a pretty good pump. I mean, I would say that there's another piece of equipment. It's heavy load K-Box, it's called. It's used as isoinertial resistance. And basically it for what you get in, like, so say you're curling it against your body, what it will give you back is more than that. So it's like 115 times the resistance. So every single repetition you do as fast as you possibly can, it will give you the eccentric or the muscle lengthening even more. So the pumps that you get, yeah, it's frictionless surface.
We'll get into that another time.
I mean, yeah.
You've already given so much knowledge right now. Because for the viewers, I don't want to drop too much. I mean, this is a lot. Wow. Where can they, if they want to start BFR, where can they begin?
I mean, you can probably follow my Instagram account. It's at the HPM, the Human Performance Mechanic. Yep. And we're going to come up with, in the next month and a half, I'll have an online course that's geared toward fitness professionals and has some rehab, but anybody that's interested in learning about the science behind the power of BFR should check it out. I mean, it's a 3-hour, 3.5-hour course, and it will allow you to feel comfortable about practicing BFR in your own practice or in your own gym, your gym workouts.
And where can they purchase anything?
So I'll have our website, we'll have all of the information. So they'll be able to. I don't sell any cuffs in particular.
Yeah.
But
you should.
But we have other relationships. Yeah, but then, you know, conversations for another day.
Okay, gotcha. So we'll have you on next time, and we'll be promoting those cuffs because I'm definitely going to buy them.
All right, brother.
Yeah, no, and I just a real quick before you leave, I think the BFR thing, would you say that because the rush of blood flow, it also brings nutrients to your muscles a lot better as well?
I mean, so basically just for whatever's
like starving your muscle, you know?
And then what I was saying before was that because of the unique effects of BFR, you also are going to create you have the potential to create new capillaries, which are arteries, like very small arteries that supply your muscle. So that can augment the pump effect and the vascularity that you can experience. So it's not just muscle. I mean, again, muscle is the easiest thing to conceptualize.
Yeah.
I lift more, I grow more, but there's other nuances that can be used. And so the paper that I wrote, another companion paper. So I wrote two papers. I wrote the first one that got published in April. That was the bodybuilding paper. That was basically my magnum opus for how to apply BFR for the physique athlete. And then I just finished, I'm hoping that it's going to be accepted soon, which is the aerobic training section. So you can apply BFR for your cardiovascular training and have the potential to actually put on some size, depending on what you kind of can do. So I wrote that also with Brad. So there's some good stuff coming out. But again, you also have to consider safety, and you can't just slap on, you know, a band and then tighten it around. Like, yes, it works. It's called practical BFR, but I feel like the technology is now coming out where it's so easy to be able to do use. So easy. Like wireless connected to your phone, like yeah. It automatically pumps up. Like really, really, really cool technology that's coming. So cool. I wouldn't hang your hat on practical BFR just because it's better to be safe with this stuff. I mean, that's just my comfort level.
Yeah. So. It definitely comes down to, everything being safe, right?
That's it. So
be smart about it and research before you do it. All right.
That's awesome. It.
Yeah, man, that's a lot of information in a little bit of time. I mean, people are definitely going to love this. Publish it.
Yeah, well, just direct them to my Instagram channel. I have the most amount of blood flow restriction posts that are on the internet.
Yeah, so, you love it, right?
I love it. All right. Well, thanks for having me, and I'm sure I'll pop on another
podcast. Oh, yeah, hell yeah, man. All right.
Stay safe out there.
You too, doctor.
Peace.
Later.